Hey everyone, welcome to another video where we're going to explore the concept of call handlers. As always, let's jump into the documentation here. And on the left hand side, let's click on create a project, jump into the mappings section where the schema GraphQL file will contain three types of handlers. We've got the block, event, and the call handler. Let's jump into the call handler and understand how it works. First of all, we use call handlers when we want to capture information on certain substrate extrinsics, also loosely known as transactions. In the example here, you can see we are using the substrate extrinsic type and extracting the block timestamp. So we're trying to grab the block timestamp of a particular transaction. The notes down here explain that the substrate extrinsic extends generic extrinsic, and this may be a bit daunting for new users, so let's jump into the code and explore what this means and more. Let's jump in as always and create the standard starter project by going subql init. And now we've got the standard starter project. enabled. Let's go into the mappings file, and this should be familiar where we've got the three functions: handle block, handle event, and handle call. We'll be focusing this video on the handle call function, but you can see here that the handle block is of type substrate block, handle event is of type substrate event. So there's a pattern in the naming convention. However, the handle call is actually substrate extrinsic. So this confuses a lot of people, especially beginners. What you can do is you can change this to handle extrinsic. For instance, just remember, if you change the function name, you'll want to go into your manifest file and also update this as well. I'll leave everything as default for now. And what I'll do is let's go and comment out the code above. And if I go ahead and try and run this, it actually won't work because I do need to tweak the code. For example, I need to declare a new instance of my starter entity object. So let's copy this down here. And in this new instance, the argument being passed to the constructor won't work because we don't have a reference to block, but we do have a reference to extrinsic. Let me save this. And again, if I run this, it still won't work because we've commented out our handle event and handle block function. So we have to go into our manifest file and remove the references here as well. Let's save this. And let's now go and generate our code. We'll also build it. And we'll spin this up in our Docker container. Now, while this loads, just a warning that I will get an error, and I'm expecting this because, for instance, in our schema file, I'm actually referencing field one. That is a mandatory field with the exclamation mark. And you may note that I've commented out field number one. Okay, so here you can see that we've got an error. The null value in field one violates a non-null constraint. So let me stop this node. I'll go into our manifest file. Let's remove the exclamation mark, meaning this is now not mandatory, but optional. And because I've modified the schema file, I do need to go and regenerate the code. I don't really have to rebuild it because I haven't actually modified the code, but I always like to build it just in case. And actually, you can see the error repeats. And the reason for this is that when I make a change to my schema file, I actually need to delete my database. So let's go into our data directory here. You can see I've got Postgres. Let's delete this. And now I can rerun this and we'll see what happens. Okay, so now the node has started and we're starting to fetch our blocks. So this code is successfully running. If we go back to our mapping handler now, let's go ahead and delete this code just to tidy things up. We can remove balance. We can remove our substrate event and block. So we can really focus on the handle call function. Now, the next question you might be asking is, what kind of information can I extract? Let me stop the node first of all, and we'll jump into the substrate extrinsic type. And then you can see here, the extrinsic, we can grab IDX, which is the unique ID. We can also jump into substrate block and substrate event. But let's jump into the extrinsic. You can see here, this extends generic extrinsic. So if we go back to the documentation, this is what this sentence means. Substrate extrinsic extends generic extrinsic. So it's saying that this substrate extrinsic type is extending generic extrinsic by way of extrinsic. So let's jump into this definition. And it's in here where you can see you can access various parameters or properties here. But if I jump further, you'll see that this extends extrinsic base. And it's in here where I can go ahead and grab the likes of argument, call index, data, error, length, for example. So let's go ahead and try this out. I'm going to make use of the logger. And we'll grab the likes of, say, the error. I can go extrinsic.error. Just have to put a plus here to get rid of that error. Let's go and see if the transaction is signed. And another parameter we can grab out is the signer. What I'll do is, it's always handy to actually also include the block height. So let's go block number. And you may recall that I can grab this from the block, the substrate block interface. So let's go block dot block dot. Now, the block height will be inside the header and it will be called number dot to number. And I just know this because I've done it enough times. So you'll also know this through practice as well. So now let's rebuild this and we'll get this up and running. And there we go. We can see the block number appearing. We've got the error and if it's signed as well. Now, what's happening here is that we're actually indexing from block zero from way back. So let me stop this because another trick is to start from a more recent block height. Let's jump into a browser and I'll paste in here subscan. And you can see the current height is around 7.2 million. So I'll click something like this. I'll copy the block height and I'll add it to our manifest file. I'll save this. Now again, the trick with changing the start block is that I need to delete my database in order for this to work. And the reason being is that my block height is actually a record inside the database so that the node knows what block height to continue from. So if I give it a different number that it's expecting, then it's not going to be happy. And again, just reiterating that all I need to do is start the node, because this is a configuration file. It just reads it in, so there's no need to do code gen or build the actual project. And there we go. It's already starting to fetch from a very recent block height. You can see we're looking at 997998. And what we can do is do a quick cross check. Let's go ahead and I'll stop the node here. We're at block 001. Let's go ahead and copy this into the likes of Subscan. And what you'll note is that in here, we actually don't have access to the likes of Signer. That's just because Subscan doesn't display it. So for example, if we go to a different blockchain explorer, such as .scanner, and we scan for the same block, what you'll see here is that in my extrinsic, I've got a Signer column, and if I scroll down, you'll see that I've got the IDs of some of these signers. So this is 13W3, this is 14, and this is 1EXA. If I look here, I've got 1EXA. I've got 14DD, which is this one here. Let me expand that for you. And if I scroll up, there should be another one, which is 13W3, which is this one here. So again, it's the ability to extract the information that you want from the extrinsic of a block. And you can do this with a call handler. And of course, you can go ahead and grab, as mentioned, maybe the version, maybe the signature, the nonce, the method, all sorts of information appropriate for your needs in order to run your dApp. So hopefully that was a little bit of an insight into how call handlers work. So go ahead and give this a try, and I'll catch you on the next video.